on the Orient Express. More specifically, the Aalborg Orient Express that ran from 1930 to 1962 from London all the way to Athens. You boarded at Paris, and as you were traveling through the Swiss Alps, a slight issue occurred and your room was flooded along with the room next door. Unfortunately, the train is full and you have no room to sleep in tonight. Instead, you have been hosted in the dining room with the roommate next door. Meet Grace, a lovely young lady that's traveled all the way from Belfast, who plans to travel to Athens and become a famous actress. She boarded at London and has not yet met you. She's had a smooth journey so far, but is very frustrated by the fact that her room has flooded. Apparently, so she says, she's really great at helping people sleep. Her grandmother taught her a few tips and tricks. Perhaps she'll be able to help you sleep tonight.
Oh, hello there. Of course you can. It's a pleasure to meet you. My name's Grace. How do you do? Excuse me, sorry I was in a bit of a trance there. It's beautiful, isn't it? The snow. They say that we're right in the Swiss Alps, through in Switzerland. It's just magical. I've never seen anything like it. Oh, I take it you were one of the unlucky ones as well. Your room must have been next to mine. What a pain. A leak. And they don't even have anywhere else to put us. So it looks like it's just gonna be me and you tonight on this carriage alone. You never know, we may get a good sleep. I suppose we have to see. Are you a good sleeper? Not really, but I'm good at making people sleep. So I could maybe help you with that. Well, take a seat. Don't be shy, there's a lot of bartender staff and there's, of course, you've got wine over there. I was just helping myself. Where are you headed? Oh, okay. Are you changing? Yeah, to go on to Istanbul. No, let's go. Did you get on at London? Paris. Oh, it was amazing. The scenery going through Paris was just wonderful. I've never seen anything like it. It brings tears to my eyes, even just thinking about how wonderful it was, honestly. No, I'm headed to Athens. Yes, this line, so I don't have to change and get the other Orient Express. Yes, I've been on since London. Of course, I'm from Belfast. Can you tell with the accent? I know, you must be thinking, what is this girl doing such a long way from home? Well, there's not a lot for me in Belfast, if I'm honest with you. I mean, I've seen it. I know I'm only young, but I feel like I've seen it and it doesn't really have much to offer for me. I want to be an actress and well, my mother thinks that I'm daft, but she let me go anyway. So I decided I'm going to get the Orient Express, I'm going to dine drink fine wines, and make my way to Athens. They're apparently due to start filming some big movies over there. Yes, Roman style. How exotic. So I thought I would go, see if I can meet anybody, you know? And what about yourself? Oh, that sounds nice. Is it to be warm? I've heard that it can be very warm over there in Turkey. What's it like? Oh, I can imagine. That's amazing. One day I'm gonna get on the Orient Express and I'm gonna get off at every single stop. I will. Every stop, I'm gonna take in the sights, I'm gonna see the towns. It's gonna be beautiful, magical, wonderful. I've always imagined, you know, Istanbul to be lots of amazing structures, a lot of sandstone buildings, a lot of moons everywhere. No? Oh, okay. No, it sounds interesting. Oh. Have you had any dinner? Okay, that's good. Yeah. Sorry, just... I get so excited that I sometimes shed a tear. But all the exciting things and possibilities and, you know, everything we've got. So, oh, it's a little bit chilly. I was hoping they would keep some heat in here now that everybody's gone to bed. Do help yourself though, there's plenty of wine. Is that what you drink? I've been helping myself to popcorn here as well. It's not something that we have often in Belfast, so it's a luxury. I couldn't believe that they have it on the train. So tell me, what do you do? Where are you from? I see. Wow, that's very interesting. No, I'm not married. Or are you? Nice. No, I do hope though that one of my trips and maybe in Athens I'll find myself a true love. It would be nice. The men I've come across so far haven't been the sharpest or the nicest. They've been pretty, but I need to have a sharp mind, an interesting personality to suit me. Here, you know, I've heard of this little rhyme. Yes, a little rhyme that can help you feel really sleepy. Yes, well, if you close your eyes, I'll do it to you. I'll set my glass down. Set it over there. Okay, I'll tell you. So close your eyes, and I'll do it now for you. Okay. Dot, dot, line, line. Spiders crawling up your spine. Tight, squeeze, cool, breeze. Crack an egg on your head, and now you've got the shiveries. Did it make you tingly? It's magic. special type of magic that only Grace here knows how to do? Do you want me to do it again? Okay. Dot, dot, line, line, spiders crawling up your spine. Tight, squeeze, cool, breathe. Neck on your head, and like you've got the shiveries, shiver, shiver, shiveries. Oh, they do say that I've got a magic touch. They used to say that at the courtyard. It's a problem with wearing fur, it's that you get it absolutely everywhere. Excuse me, that wasn't very ladylike. Would you look at that? I'm almost finished my glass of wine. I'll hopefully need to get some more. I like this. Are you a wine drinker yourself? Yes. Well, this is apparently a Merlot. It apparently comes from South California. I would love to go to the US. Get on the boat. Wow. That would be my next stop if I wasn't heading to Athens on the Orient Express. Oh. You do look awfully sleepy, God. A little nightcap won't hurt. I do have some lotions and potions. I've seen you rub your neck a little bit. Why is that? It's sore. Oh dear, from the... Oh. I think I've got something that might help you. Yes. Hold on a little moment. I'll just get my bag. A little invention that my granny got me. She said, "Set it by a warm fire, and it'll heat up these special little lavender beads inside. And listen to the sound of it." She said, "Grace, doesn't this remind you of the sea?" And I thought to myself, you know, it really does. I could just imagine myself in Athens with the sound of the sea hitting the shore. It's beautiful. The reason I've got it out today is that it's meant to help with any neck pain. Here, why don't you take it? Just, I'll sit it here. Let it drop it to you. There. Yes, pick it up, that's it. Put it around your neck. See? The heat will give your neck a little bit of stress relief. A little bit less tense, and hopefully that'll help. It's not going to be comfortable sleeping on the chairs tonight. No. No, it'll just be me and you. I hope that nobody steals. I mean, steals. Who am I to speak? This is the luxurious, the most luxurious train that you'll ever be on. I know. Who am I to speak? There will be no concern. I wouldn't imagine it that anybody would take our belongings. Sometimes I always have a little bit of a worry in the back of my mind. I know. Oh dear. Oh dear. But it's fine. You know, we're here. We have water and wine. And also there's apparently some scotch that might make you fall right asleep. And we've got each other to help. A little bit of company. I'll look out for you if you look out for me. Good. A little bit of company doesn't go amiss, eh? At least I'm not here alone. You know, so Moorish. You know, I've got a couple of like really innovative, like new, they say it could be a little bit of black magic, but I don't think so. Items in my handbag that might help you sleep. And I've also got a book. Yes, I could read you a fairy tale. Pour some more wine, or read a fairy tale. And help us both hopefully get to sleep. Okay. Let me get the wine first. I have to make sure that I pour it. Cheers. Don't judge. Okay, so I have two items here. Okay, one of them is a spray. It's made, I'm not even gonna show you, but it has lots of healing and calming properties in it. And my gran gave it to me. She said, "Here, Grace, use this whenever you can't sleep." And I have, and it's just amazing at knocking me out. So, would you like me to spray it on you? Just spray it around. Kind of around, like, your suit and, like, around your chair headrest. Yeah? Okay. How's that? It smells really great, doesn't it? And this one is like a special balm. You like put it on your wrists and it makes you feel really like calm and soothed and ready to sleep. So here, I'll put it on mine. Let's put it on yours. I'm sure this will bring us many happy memories. So, let's take a big, long swig. It's just beautiful, isn't it? The snow. It really makes me feel like Christmas. I know it's only October, but oh, it's just magical. I'm hoping it's still warm when I get to Athens, but it might start to get a little bit cooler now, so I'm gonna wrap up nice and warm. It was awfully wet when I traveled all the way through, when I got the ferry over to Scotland and then had to get up to Glasgow and then get another train from Glasgow to London and then get the train, the Orient Express from London, but it was so busy and so wet. Oh my goodness, it was so cold. I love autumn, but not when it's wet. When it's cold and crisp, you can't beat it. Not with the colors from the trees. So, would you like me to read you a story? Okay. Let's do this. Given from my ground. I'll find you something nice to read. Something not too long and something not too short. Portrait. Hello, there's Miliel, said somebody near me. I looked at the man who had been pointed out, as I had been wishing for a long time to meet this Don Juan. He was no longer young. His grey hair looked a little like those fur bonnets worn by certain northern people, and his long beard, which fell below his chest, had also somewhat the appearance of fur. He was talking to a lady, leaning toward her, speaking in a low voice, and looking at her with an expression full of respect and tenderness. I knew his life, or at least as much as was known of it. He had loved madly several times, and there had been certain tragedies with which his name had been connected. When I spoke to the woman, who were the loudest in his praise, and asked them whence came this power, they always answered, after thinking for a while, I don't know. He has a certain charm about him. He was certainly not handsome. He had none of the elegance that we ascribe to the conquerors of feminine hearts. I wondered, what might be his hidden charm? Was it mental? I never had heard of a clever saying of his, in his glance, perhaps, or in his voice. The voices of some beings have a certain irresistible attraction, almost suggesting the flavor of things good to eat. One is hungry for them, and the sound of their words penetrates us like a dainty morsel. A friend was passing. I asked him, Do you know Monsieur Miliel? Yes. Introduce us. A minute later, we were shaking hands and talking in the doorway. What he said was correct, agreeable to hear. It contained no irritable thought. The voice was sweet, soft, caressing, musical, but I had heard others much more attractive, much more moving. One listened to him with pleasure, just as one would look at a pretty little brook. No tension of the mind was necessary in order to follow him. No hidden meaning around curiosity, and no expectation awoke interest. His conversation was rather restful, but it did not awaken in one either a desire to answer, to contradict, or to approve, and it was as easy to answer him as it was to listen to him. The response came to the lips of its own accord. As soon as he had finished talking, the phrases turned toward him as if he had naturally aroused them. One thought soon struck me. I had known him for a quarter of an hour, and it seemed as if he were already one of my old friends, that I had known all about him for a long time. His face, his gestures, his voice, his ideas. Suddenly, after a few minutes of conversation, he seemed already to be installed in my intimacy. All constraint disappeared between us, and had he so desired, I might have confided in him as one of my confides only in old friends. Certainly there was some mystery about him. Those barriers that are closed between people and that are lowered with time when sympathy, similar tastes, equal intellectual culture, and constant intercourse remove constraints. Those barriers seemed not to exist between him and me, and no doubt this was the case between him and all people, both men and women whom fate threw in his path. After an hour we parted, promising to see each other often, and he gave me his address after inviting me to take luncheon with him in 2 days. I forgot what hour he had stated, and as I arrived too soon, he was not yet home. A correct and silent domestic showed me into a beautiful, quiet, softly lighted parlour. I felt comfortable there, at home. How often I have noticed the influence of apartments on the character and on the mind. There are some ways make one feel foolish, in others, on the contrary, one always feels lively. Some make us sad, although well lighted and decorated in light coloured furniture. Others cheer us up, although hung with sombre material. Our eye, like our heart, has its likes and dislikes, of which it does not inform us, and which it secretly imposes on our temperament. The harmony of furniture walls, the style and ensemble act immediately on our mental state, just as the air from the woods, the sea, or the mountains modifies our physical natures. I sat down on a cushion-covered divan and felt myself suddenly carried and supported by those little silk bags of feathers, as if this is the outline of my body had been marked out beforehand on this couch. Then I looked about. There was nothing striking about the room. Everywhere were beautiful and modest things, simple and rare furniture, oriental curtains, which did not seem to come from a department store but from the interior of a harem. And exactly opposite me hung the portrait of a woman. It was a portrait of a medium size, showing the head and the upper part of the body and the hands, which were holding a book. She was young, bareheaded, ribbons were woven in her hair. She was smiling sadly. Was it because she was bareheaded? Was it merely her natural expression? I have never seen a portrait of a lady which seemed so much in its place as that one in the dwelling. All those I know are on exhibition, whether the lady be dressed in her gaudiest gown with an attractive headdress and a look which shows that she is posing first of all before the artist and then before those who will look at her, or whether they have taken a comfortable attitude to an ordinary gown. Some are standing majestically in all their beauty, which is not at all natural to them in life. All of them have something, a flower or a jewel, a crease in the dress or a curve of the lip, which one feels to have been placed there for effect by the artist. Whether they wear a hat or merely their hair, one can immediately notice that they are not entirely natural. Why? One cannot say without knowing them, but the effect is there. They seem to be calling somewhere on people whom they wish to please and to whom they wish to appear at their best advantage. And they have studied their attitudes, sometimes modest, sometimes haughty. What could one say about this one? She was at home and alone. Yes, she was alone, for she was smiling as one smiles when thinking of solitude or something sad or sweet, and not as one smiles when is being watched. She seemed so much alone and so much at home that she made the whole large apartment seem absolutely empty. She alone lived in it, filled it, gave it life. Many people might come in and converse, laugh, even sing. She would still be alone with a solitary smile, and she alone would give it life with her pictured gaze. That look was unique. It fell directly on me, fixed and caressing, without seeing me. All portraits know what they are being watched, and they answer with their eyes, which see, think, follow us without leaving us. From the very moment we enter the apartment they inhabit, this one did not see me, it saw nothing, although its look was fixated directly on me. I remembered the surprising verse of Baudelaire, "And your eyes attractive as those of a portrait." They did indeed attract me in an irresistible manner. Those painted eyes which had lived, or which were perhaps still living, threw over me a strange, powerful spell. Oh, what an infinite and tender charm, like a passing breeze, like a dying sunset of lilac rose and blue, a little sad like the approaching night, which comes behind the somber frame and out of those impenetrable eyes. Those eyes, created by a few strokes of a brush, hide behind them the mystery of that which seems to be and which does not exist, which can appear in the eyes of a woman, which can make love blossom within us. The door opened and M. Milliel entered. He excused himself for being late. I excused myself for being ahead of time. Then I said, "Might I ask you, who is this lady?" He answered, "That is my mother. She died very young." Then I understood whence came the inexplicable attraction of this man. So, there we have it. That is the book. You look awfully sleepy, my dear. Rest your head. Gaze out the window. I think that's what I'll do now, with my glass of wine, and hopefully pass this strange but exciting night on the Orient Express.